welcome to Living Word Ministries with our director and Bible teacher, Debbie Blank. Debbie's passion is for you to understand and apply God's truths to your life. Now let's listen and enjoy teaching from the Word of God with Debbie Blank.
Oh, Father, we do invite you here tonight. You are everywhere, but your word says where two or three are gathered together in your name, there you are in our midst. And we are gathered in your name for your word, to speak the truth, to learn the truth, to grow in truth. As we study tonight's lesson, boy, it just parallels so much with what we're going through in this world. This whole book does, but tonight's lesson again does also. So we ask you to speak to us, because there's also a lot of practical application here. And Father, let us leave each night changed by your Holy Spirit. If just one thing speaks to us, we've walked away renewed and refreshed. But we also ask for more. We want to know you better. We want to know your truth and your word. And we want to transfer that into life application. Not enough to know you. It's enough to get to heaven to know you as our Lord and Savior. But we also have a responsibility to walk in a manner worthy of you. So speak to us, God. Teach us. Guide us in everything. Through the power of your Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our Messiah, we pray. Amen. Before we start tonight's lesson, we always have to do a little review, because Ezekiel is a long book. We want you to remember as we go through what the book is about. We learned chapters 1 and 3 were all about that doesn't say it up there. What did Ezekiel have in chapter 1 that was unique? Does anybody remember? A vision. There's lots of visions in the book of Ezekiel. Lots of visions that Ezekiel has. And he had a vision, and in this vision, what did God do? He called Ezekiel, and he commissioned Ezekiel to go and speak forth his truth, his word. That was a great study, those first three chapters. Then we move into chapter 4, and it's not so much fun. Chapters 4 and 7 aren't quite as much fun, because this is Israel's destruction that it's coming. It's coming first. We saw 5 signs of the destruction, examples of what the destruction was going to be looking like. Then in chapter 6, we saw the judgment on the mountains. Last week, we read the first part of chapter 7, which was, it says the end is coming, but it's also the judgment on the land. So a little different. Tonight, we're going to focus on the rest of chapter 7, as well as chapters 8 and chapters 9. Chapter 7, the focus that we're going to be having tonight is the end is coming. And if the end is coming, then the question is why? The answer is right there in chapter 7. Why? That they may know I am the Lord. So then if the end is coming, we also have to ask, what have the people done that is causing this end to come? That's what we're going to see in chapter 8. The 4 abominations, what the people have done. And finally, in chapter 9, we're going to see how God slays his people. How actually God brings about, he slays his people. He goes into the temple and slays his people. And then hopefully also we'll get into chapter 10, which will talk about the departure of God's glory. That's a result of the people disobeying God, is God's going to leave. He's going to slay them and he's going to leave. I don't want that here in the United States. I don't want that in my life. So let's pay attention tonight as we learn and we listen to find out what we can do that perhaps can change that. Well, the first thing we see in chapter 7 that we talked about last week, and we start with, as we start in verse 10 of chapter 7 of Ezekiel, is the grim reaper. The end is near. What do you think when you see someone on the street corner going, the end is near, destruction is coming, it's time for the end of the world? What do you think when you see someone like that? What? She says a pretty smart dude. She's right. But let's be honest. We look at him and we kind of go, he's a weirdo. There's a better way of saying this. There's a better way of doing this. But is there? I mean, if you want to get people's attention, this is clearly the way some people are called to get it. I'm not. This isn't what I'm called to do, but if God called me to do it, I do it. How about you? Well, God calls all of us to let people know the end is coming. Whether we do it this way, whether we do it in conversation, whether we do it in teaching as I do, or however you do it, we need to be speaking forth the truth. And the truth is, we are living in times that match up with the end times in the Bible. That means Jesus is coming soon. But people don't recognize that. Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Peter chapter 3. And let's keep in mind, as we're looking at this passage, and as we're thinking of our day, people listened to Ezekiel. Ezekiel spoke the truth, they listened to him. They listened to Jeremiah. They did, just because they listened didn't mean they believed, nor did they follow. Clearly, they didn't. But they had the opportunity to listen. Again, they didn't obey and they didn't follow, and that's what's happening today. In 2 Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 3, it says, "Know this first of all, that in the last days," that's the time before the return of Jesus Christ, in those weeks or months or years, "mockers will come with their mocking, following after their own lusts, and saying, 'Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation.' When they maintain this, it escapes their notice that by the word of God, the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and by water." Now, if you caught some of these things in here, they're saying that this is going to happen in the last days. Who's going to come forward in the last days, according to verse 3? Mockers. People who mock those of us who believe that we're in the end times. People who mock people who stand on the street corners. You may not agree with how they do it, but you've got to listen to what they say because it's true. However, nobody wants to hear it. In Jeremiah, especially in chapter 23, people did not want to hear that the end was coming. By the way, I mentioned Jeremiah. When did Jeremiah live? During the same time as Ezekiel. Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel were three major prophets in the Bible that all were contemporaries of one another. Ezekiel and Daniel were one place. Where was that? Babylon. They had been taken captive in Babylon. Where was Jeremiah? He was in Jerusalem. So they were contemporaries, but they were in different locations. Jeremiah used to preach that the end was coming. And people put him in prison. People said he was a false prophet. People said he wasn't telling the truth. People didn't believe him, and he was right there in Jerusalem. Now, it's easier, I think, for people to have believed Daniel and Ezekiel because they've already been taken captive. She said that they like movies, and that they, have you noticed in the last 5 years how many apocalyptic-type movies are out there? Because people really do have a sense that something is wrong. Something's happening. Something big is going to happen, but they're not necessarily willing to admit what it is. They think it's more of a catastrophe, a natural catastrophe, rather than these are the signs of the end times. Statistically speaking, most people in the United States believe we're in the end times. And most of them believe that the revelation, what's talked about in Revelation, is going to come true. I don't have the statistics with me tonight, but you'd be surprised at how many people believe. I think it's like in the 70% believe that we are living in the end times. That's a lot of people. He said, and he's right, when people do things like this, that we look at them and go, oh, maybe there's a different way to do this, they've been saved from something, and they want other people to understand it. When you look at some of the most radical Jesus freaks, for lack of a better phrase, of which I was one when I first became a believer, because I knew I was different, and I wanted everybody to know about it, I just didn't quite know what I was. I remember turning to a gal that I knew and saying, oh, what am I now? I know I'm not a particular religion I grew up in, but I don't know what I am. So I just called myself a Jesus freak. But I was so excited to be saved by God, I would have done anything. So people that do these kinds of things or carry the cross around the world or do other things, they want to get the message out. Either God has called them to do it, or they're so in love with Jesus, they want to get the truth out. On Sunday night, we have a TV show on at 9:30 on Cox Cable Channel 22. Right before us, I can't think of his name, but there's a guy on TV right before us, and I love the guy. Because ever since I first saw him probably 20 or 30 years ago, this guy is radically on fire for Jesus. And he's not ashamed to say it. He puts up billboards, and he does all kinds of other things because he is radically in favor. Anthony Yates. Anthony Yates. He is radically on fire for Jesus Christ. And some people might go, oh, he's a little out there. But who cares? He's doing what God has called him to, and he's great. I love that in him. All right, let's go back to 2 Peter. So it says, in the last days, mockers are going to come with their mockings and their own lusts, their own desires, what they want to do. And they're going to make fun of us saying, well, when's the promise of his coming? We've been told that for centuries and it's never happened. And what's fascinating to me is we're at verse 5. Because verse 5, it's going to say, when this happens, basically, it escapes their notice that God is the creator. And I'm paraphrasing this. It escapes their notice that God is creator. When did it happen in all of mankind that it escapes people's notice that God is the creator? Or let's say in the last 2,000 years since Christ. Just the last 100 years with evolution. Otherwise, people, Christians and other people, have been believing from the beginning. Even Muslims believe that Allah is the creator. Different God than us, but they believe that. But what this is saying is in the last days, it's going to be at a time when they don't believe God's a creator anymore. They're going to have that same attitude of mocking. That's what's happening to Jeremiah. That's what's happening to Ezekiel. But Ezekiel continues to speak the truth. Well, let's go on now and look at Ezekiel 7, 10 through 13. It says, behold, the day is coming. Behold, it's coming. Now, when God says something once, you need to listen. And when he says it twice, it's really important. Three times, you better take it and do something with it. But here, twice, right here, he's saying, behold, the day is coming. Turn with me to Revelation 22. Just finished a radio show on this today. And I thought, isn't this interesting? The end of the book of Revelation, the very end, which means it's time for these things to be completed. And in order to, Jesus says, it's when it starts, it's going to happen quickly. He says in the very last book of the Bible, Revelation 22, 7, behold, I am coming quickly. Then he says in verse 12, I am coming quickly. He says again in verse 20, I am coming quickly. Three times he says it. Now we're talking here about the second coming of Jesus Christ in Revelation. In Ezekiel, that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the destruction. The point is that God warns his people when he's coming. He says, behold, behold, it's coming. And what's coming according to verse 10 in Ezekiel chapter 7? The doom. Your doom has gone forth. Then it says, the rod has budded, arrogance has blossomed. What's the rod? What does it mean the rod has budded? The rod and Aaron's staff? Well, that's something we see in Scripture. Aaron's staff that budded, but in the context here, when it's talking about gloom and doom, I think it's talking about something different than that. The time is now. It's time for God's wrath to be poured out. And so when it says the rod has budded, he's talking about Babylon, the country that is going to defeat Israel. They're ready. It's budded. I mean, we're seeing the trees bud now. That means they're starting to become fruitful. Babylon is becoming fruitful in its pursuit of Israel. Arrogance has blossomed. Certainly, we're going to continue to see that as we go down. What else has happened in verse 11? Violence has grown into the rod of wickedness. Have we seen that lately in the United States? Or in the world? I mean, we just saw it last weekend. A lot of it that was instigated. Violence has grown. None of them shall remain, none of their people, none of their wealth, nor anything evident or imminent among them. Now, just to keep this in context, when it's talking here about violence is growing, it's talking about two different groups of people. The rod is budded is Babylon, who's going to come down against Israel. When it's talking about wickedness and violence and the people and that their wealth and nothing is going to be among them, that's talking about the Jews. Okay, that's the context. I was just making some application as to what we're seeing around here. There's to make the point that when you see a lot of violence, when you see a lot of chaos and destruction, that very well means that something's coming. Verse 12. Yeah. Verse 12. The time has come. The day has arrived. Now, has it really when he's writing this? No, because if you recall, the date's 592 BC. Babylon's going to destroy Jerusalem in 586 BC. So we're still 6 years away. But what he's saying is, you're going to have to go through all these problems now because of your sin until the final culmination comes. So when people say to me, when do you believe the rapture is going to take place? I believe the rapture is going to take place before the tribulation starts. I think that's God's plan for the church. That's my opinion. There's lots of opinions out there. But even if I'm right, I believe we're still going to have to go through a lot of hell before that happens here on earth. Because it's not going to be like God says, okay, I'm going to take the church out, and then I'm going to let tough times happen. I think we're in those right now. If you look back 5 years ago, nobody had heard of ISIS. We knew of who Al-Qaeda was. We were told 4 years ago that Al-Qaeda was done with when we killed Osama bin Laden. When we look at all the violence and the things that have happened in the last 5 years, I've prided myself on a statement. Whenever we go to Israel, people have two problems with going to Israel. One is money, and the other one is fear. That's generally it. Sometimes it's timing. Of course, you have to be called in the first place, but it's generally fear and money. I've said no tourist has been killed in Israel for over 40 years. I can't say that anymore, because an American tourist was killed last week. And a place that we've been. In 2013, we were right there on that plaza, walking that boardwalk where they were killed. The world has become a much more violent place. It's going to continue. God, I believe, will take us out before the tribulation starts, but that doesn't mean that we're not going to have a lot of problems before. That's what we're seeing here. Okay. That's what we're seeing here is a lot of problems before the catastrophe comes in 6 years. So when people start mocking and saying, well, we've got a lot of things going on, but that doesn't necessarily mean Jesus is coming soon. It's just the beginning of birth pangs, as Matthew 24 says. Again, let's go back to verse 12. The time has come, the day has arrived. Then he says, let not the buyer rejoice, nor the seller mourn, for wrath is against all their multitude. Indeed, the seller will not regain what he sold as long as they both live. For the vision regarding all their multitude will not be averted, nor will any of them maintain his life by his iniquity. That's a mouthful. What's the main topic here? What are they talking about specifically? Doesn't sound very loud. Is it loud enough for you guys? Okay. What's the main topic here in these two verses? If you've got a buyer and a seller, what are you talking about? Money, property, wealth, something in that regard. So how come he's making a point here of what time is going to be like during these last 6 years? So how come the buyer isn't going to rejoice and the seller isn't going to mourn? I mean, what are they talking about here? Any ideas? Okay, destruction. Destruction of the economic system. Money will have no value. We'll see it in a little while, a little bit more poignantly. But money's not going to have any value. I mean, some of us have money hid away. Some people have gold hidden away. I mean, some people have some assets hidden away. There may come a time when they're not worth anything. They don't have any value. She said there's almost no value in it now. They keep printing money at the quantitative easing, and that may indeed happen. He said this verse 12 reminds him of what France was like in World War II. The people had to take wheelbarrows of money just to get a loaf of bread. I mean, it's a tough time. Now, there's another aspect of this. Let's turn to Leviticus chapter 25. Because here it tells us that something special happens every 50 years. The Jubilee. And I'm just going to read you a couple of verses. But in the Jubilee, in Leviticus 25:10, it says, "You shall thus consecrate the 50th year and proclaim a release through the land to all its inhabitants. It should be a Jubilee year for you, and each of you shall return to his own property, and each one of you shall return to his family." It says in verse 14, "If you make a sale, moreover, to your friend, or buy from your friend's hand, you shall not wrong one another. Correspondingly to the number of years after the Jubilee, you shall buy from your friend. He is to sell to you according to the number of years of crops." Well, we're not going to go in and explain all that, except to say that at the year of Jubilee, everything reverted back to its owner. Now, what you had to do was you had to buy things back commensurately based on the proportionate amount of years that has been involved. So it's a buying and selling of the Jews to each other of their property. This is saying, don't wait for the Jubilee, folks. It's not coming. That's in effect what they're doing. Don't plan on it. The buyer, let not the buyer rejoice nor the seller mourn. There's not going to be any benefit to anybody here at the time of Jubilee.
That's next year.
I know. Some people believe it's next year in the Jewish calendar. The Jubilee. Well, there's no certainty, but yes, a lot of people believe. So she's relating this to now, to our times now, that if next year is indeed the Jubilee, some people even think it's this year, that this could relate to us. The point is, money is worthless. The Bible, just a side note here. What should we do with our money? What's the best way to invest our money? Does anybody have a biblical answer for that?
Give it to the Lord.
Oh, amen. Give it to the Lord. It's His anyway. Marianne.
It all belongs to Him. It doesn't belong to us in the first place.
It all belongs to Him. It doesn't belong to us in the first place. That's right, but He does give it to us to use. So what should we do to it to protect it? I've got the answer. I don't have the answer. God has the answer. Ecclesiastes 11:2. I can't tell you how to put this into application, but I can tell you what God says. "Divide your portion to seven or even to eight, for you don't know what misfortune may occur on the earth." So, put your money in seven or eight different places. Real estate, gold, stocks, cash, who knows, whatever else. That's what God offers. Maybe investments overseas, maybe whatever. Seven or eight places, so if you lose some in one, you've still got something elsewhere. That's what God says. In this case, however, there was going to be nothing. Their wealth was going to mean nothing. Verses 14 to 16 now, we look at another. Oh, let me show you some comparisons here. Because we've gone through some and we'll go through some more. As I was reading through these, I kept thinking, boy, that sounds like the book of Revelation. So even though Ezekiel is talking about a time of 586 BC, the book of Revelation is still yet future. That means that the trouble, the wrath of God that's going to come upon the world during that period of time, the seven-year period of time that's mentioned from chapters 6 to 19 in Revelation, are still yet future. And isn't it interesting how much they coalesce? They're similar between the book of Ezekiel and the book of Revelation. That means that you and I can learn from what's happening in Ezekiel because similar things are going to happen in the future with the time of Revelation. I don't believe we'll be here, but if we are, we better be ready. First thing is the timing. The day is coming. I read to you, I am coming quickly. The rod has budded. That means the enemy is ready. And in chapter 6 to 18 of Revelation, we know the time is ripe. We're right there because it matches up with what's happening in the world today. When I say we're right there, I don't mean we're in the tribulation, but it could happen at any time. Arrogance. In Ezekiel, it's talking about the arrogance of the priests, specifically, and the people. And Revelation, we see in chapters 13 and 16, blasphemies from the religious leaders of that time. Violence. Well, we talked about back in verse 10, it has grown into wickedness in the Four Horses of the Apocalypse of the chapter 6 of Revelation, we see violence. Starts out as peace, then as famine, then it's war, it's famine, and eventually a fourth of the world is going to be killed. Here we see that wealth is useless. In chapter 13, we see the mark of the beast. You're going to have the mark of the beast to buy or sell. So it doesn't matter if you got all the money in the world. If you don't have the mark of the beast, you won't be able to buy or sell. Money will not be used. You know, we're moving into a cashless society. Why do you think that is? It's in preparation. There's a lot of good, rational, political reasons for it. I understand that. But ultimately, it's leading us to Revelation 13. The wrath. We see and we'll see as we continue in here. The wrath of God is against them. Well, the wrath of God is permeating in the book of Revelation. You see it first in chapter 6, verses 16 and 17, all the way through chapter 19. And it's not just the wrath of God. It's the thumos and the orge wrath. It's the worst possible wrath. Thumos, orge is a mental wrath. Thumos is the action that comes out of that mental wrath. That's throughout the book of Revelation. Sword, famine, and plague is going to consume them in Ezekiel. And as I said, in Revelation 6, a fourth of the world is killed. Blaspheming we see going on in Ezekiel, or we will in a few minutes, in the holy place of all places. And then in the book of Matthew, chapter 24, which correlates to Revelation, we see the abomination of desolation, which is the worst blasphemy. Calling yourself God in the temple of God, desecrating the holy place, just like we're going to see here. A lot of correlations between Ezekiel and Revelation. And if, by the way, you came in late, I forgot to send you out the PowerPoint of this, so I'll send it out tomorrow or later on tonight. Now let's turn to verses 14 to 16. We're going to find something else that's going to happen. They have blown the trumpet and made everything ready, but no one's going to go to battle. For what? What does it say? My wrath is against all their multitude. It doesn't just say it's against the men or the women or the priests or this. Who's it against? All their multitude. Don't think that those of us who are righteous aren't going to have to suffer right along with people who are unrighteous. We may not have to go through the tribulation, but we're still going to suffer in the name of Jesus. God's wrath is against him. He says in verse 15, the sword is outside and the plague and famine are within. We've seen that earlier, chapter 5. He who is in the field will die by the sword. Famine and the plague will also consume those in the city. However, verse 16, there's some hope. It says, even when their survivors escape, what does that mean? There's going to be a remnant of people that God allows to get through this. We've seen that before. We'll continue to see the remnant that God allows. He says, even when their survivors escape, they'll be on the mountains like doves of the valley, all of them mourning each over his own iniquity. What does it mean they're going to be like mountains? They're going to be on the mountains like doves in the valleys. And it just means that the doves will be flying to the mountains and the people are going to be flying to the mountains. They're going to want to get away, so they're going to run away to the mountains. Each over his own iniquity. Now, this makes it sound like these survivors they may be a remnant of survivors, but they're not believing survivors, because it says each over his own iniquity. So we have here mourning. People are going to be mourning over what's going to be happening. Then as we move on to 17 to 19, it says, all hands will hang limp and all knees will become like water. What is that a picture of? Fear. I mean, if your knees become weak, you know, you're like this. And your knees become like water, they have no substance. They can't hold you up because of fear. They will gird themselves with sackcloth, and shuddering will overwhelm them. What is sackcloth used for? Mourning. So we're talking really mourning here. It doesn't mention mourning earlier, even though I did, but now you're actually seeing it. And shuddering will overwhelm them, just that fear. And shame will be on all their faces and baldness on all their heads. Why baldness? Why shame, first of all? Why are the people going to be ashamed? Okay, because they've turned away from God. They've turned away from God. It's not just because the Babylonians are coming. The Babylonians are a consequence to their sin, to their shame. And then it says, and baldness on all their heads. Linda? Okay, it's a sign of mourning also, shaving your heads. They will fling their silver into the streets, and their gold will become an abhorrent thing. Their silver and their gold will not be able to deliver them when? In the day of wrath of the Lord. They cannot satisfy their appetite, nor can they fill their stomachs, for their iniquity has become an occasion of stumbling. So here you have it, just what we were talking about earlier. Wheelbarrows full of gold won't buy you any food because there's such a famine in the city. Your money is worthless. You can fling it out into the streets. It's worthless. Why? Their iniquity has become an occasion of stumbling. You notice how many times iniquity, pride, arrogance, shame, all these negative emotions are attached to the Israelites? Huh. When do we feel those negative emotions? I mean, in our lives, when do we feel those things? What are we having to do to bring us to that kind of an attitude? Exactly right. When we do something wrong. When we do something wrong, then we're shameful. And our arrogance might make us cover it up, but a lot of times that's a sign of doing something wrong. These are all attitudes of doing something wrong, sinning against God. Verses 20 to 23. They transform the beauty of his ornaments into pride. And then, well, let's stop right there. What are his ornaments? Where are God's ornaments? What are they referring to here? The items from the sanctuary. When he talks about the ornaments, he's talking about the temple, things in the temple. What is the temple? Well, you know what? I'm going to hold that thought because we're going to talk about it when we get to the next chapter. Anyway, they transform the beauty of in the temple because of their pride. In other words, they take the things in the temple and they make them into graven images. They make the images of their abominations, their detestable things with it. Therefore, I will make it an abhorrent thing to them. So they're taking God's precious items from the place where God dwells. And right here in this verse, God is still dwelling in the temple. They go in, they take the items, and then they go out and fashion them into a golden image of some sort, or some silver image. Do we do that? Let me just give you an example. Do we take our money and do we use it for what we want instead of tithing to God's kingdom? Now, that's a tough one. I mean, I used to, you know, 30 years ago, before I understood the principle of tithing, 30 plus years ago, I'd, you know, once in a while drop a $10 bill on the plate or a $20 bill on the plate and, you know, thought, aren't I really good to do that? And then I learned the principle of the tithing and realized that it's a lot more than $10 or $20 here or there. Now, we could discuss that all night. We could also discuss where your tithe should go, but we're going to let God work with you on that. The point is, everything, as we discussed earlier, everything we have comes from God. And God wants a tenth of it back. Does he need our money? No, he doesn't. Then why does he want it? Okay, that shows obedience. It helps us to understand our need for him. Reminds us that he's the one that gave us everything we have. Absolutely. It also shows our heart. Are you willing to write a check to God before you do what you want to do? Or even before you do what you have to do? You know, that's a little practical application you can learn from this. And that is the importance. If we're not tithing, then we're disobeying God and his word. And by the way, some people will say, well, tithing was first mentioned in the Old Testament. When? Anybody know? Before Malachi. Genesis, and you're close with the muh sound, but it's Melchizedek. Yeah, I got several people raise their hand then. Melchizedek in Genesis chapter 14. That was the first tithe. And some people will say, well, that's Old Testament. We don't have time now because we're under grace. We're in the New Testament. Oh. Let me just take you to a verse. Oh, some of you are just cringing in your chairs because you never thought tithing would come up tonight. 2 Corinthians. Quite frankly, I didn't either. So I'm telling you, somebody needs this tonight because I never quite know what direction God's going to take me. And this was definitely not on my radar. So let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. We'll just look at a couple verses. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. Now this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. In other words, if you give little to the Lord, you're going to benefit little from the Lord. That's not why we give, by the way. We give to honor God. But the outcome is if we are stingy, then God is not allowed, can't bless us because we're being stingy with him. Can he bless us? Sure. But the idea is he won't. He who sows sparingly shall also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully shall also reap bountifully. I just heard a story tonight from someone who went out of their box and gave of their time and their money to do something for ministry. And it was really quite a wonderful thing that they did for that ministry. Guess what happened? Within a few days, they got a side job offer that paid them extra money. Now, did the person do the number one thing in order to get something back from God? No, they did it because God led them to do it to bless a ministry. And then what did God do? He who sows bountifully shall also reap bountifully. God poured blessings out on that person for what that person did. That's how God works. Now, if you set out and you go, boy, I'm going to give $20 to the plate this week and then God's going to give me 20 or 40 back. Wrong attitude. Verse 7, let each one do just as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Do you laugh when you put your money in the plate? I mean, I've gone through some pretty tough times financially. You know, my husband being an entrepreneur, we're kind of up and down and up and down and everywhere in the middle. You never know where we're going to be. And there have been lots of times when we've been down. And I want you to know, when I first learned tithing, we were down. And we had no money to tithe, but we did. And it was fun because I knew I was being obedient to God. And I could tell you stories, but not tonight, of what God did. I wasn't under compulsion. I knew I had to do it because God called me to do it, and I was convicted to do it. But I did it because God wanted me to do it. Verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, that always, having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. So, you can also look at Matthew 23 when Jesus talks about the Pharisees tithing. Now, obviously, he's talking about the Pharisees tithing. He's not telling us we have to, but he does bring tithing into the New Testament. Quite frankly, you and I have a greater responsibility to meet the needs of people in the New Testament than we ever did in the Old. That's why in Acts chapter 2, when the church came together for the first time at Pentecost, it said people were selling that what they had and putting it at the feet of the apostles to meet the needs of people. Oh, that's a lot more than 10%. So, sorry. For whomever God is convicting, you needed it because God says you did, not because I do. But that's the principle of tithing. These people, it says here, basically, we don't take God's ornaments and make graven images out of them. But by taking what's God's and using it for our purposes, that's what we're doing. Verse 21, I will give it into the hands of the foreigners as plunder and to the wicked of the earth as spoil as they profane it. Now, what's he talking about? What's he going to give into the hands of foreigners? Okay, the articles from the temple, the silver, the gold that they've used, it's going to go into their hands. Verse 22 says, I will also turn my face from them, and they will profane what? Yeah, he says, my secret places. What's the most secret place in the temple? The Holy of Holies. They're going to profane the Holy of Holies. What's in the Holy of Holies? The Ark of the Covenant. One piece of furniture. On top of it is the mercy seat with two cherubim. And what's so special about the Holy of Holies? What? It's a place where God dwelt when he was in the temple, where the high priest spoke to God. This is the place where God was when God was in the temple. This is the most holy place of all Judaism, the Holy of Holies. And only one person could go in there once a year. It's that holy. And he had better be sinless. Because if he wasn't, he had to wear bells on the bottom of his garment. And if they didn't hear the bells ringing, he also had a rope on his foot. If they didn't hear the bells ringing, they knew he wasn't sinless. He had died and they had to pull him out. Because they couldn't go in to get him. It's that important. And these people, it says, they have profaned God's holy place. Now, we learned last week they're eating their children because they're hungry. They profane God's holy place. I mean, now, how much worse can things get? I don't know that they can get any worse than that. Verse 23, make the chain captivity, for the land is full of, what does God call them? Bloody crimes, and the city is full of violence. Bloody crimes. This is horrendous, is what God is saying. But he's not finished. He's got more to say. He says in verse 24, therefore. What does therefore mean? It points back to what he's just talked about. And what has he just talked about in general? The sin of the people. The way they've turned away from God. Therefore, because of everything that you have done, I will bring the worst of the nations. And at that time, Babylon was the worst of the nations. And they will possess their houses. I will also make the pride of the strong ones cease, and their holy places will be profaned. Now, we women, what makes us most secure in life is a home. I mean, that's our security. For us to lose our home is pretty difficult for women. But it's also a man's pride. This says that they're going to come in and they're going to take your houses. How would you like it if someone came in today and took over your house and you had nothing to say about it? That's what's going to happen here. And the holy places are going to be profaned. The pride of the strong ones, in other words, the warriors, aren't going to be able to stand up against this enemy. Verse 25, when anguish comes, they will seek, what? Peace. And will they find it? No, there is no peace. And that's what happens. When things occur that we're not ready for, we have no peace. Today, if something happened that we weren't ready for, how can we have peace? Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Jehovah Shalom, the God of Peace. He will give us the peace of God that surpasses all understanding to guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, no matter what the situation. And that's Philippians 4:7. If you haven't memorized it, memorize it. Because if you haven't had a time when you need peace, you will come to a time when you need peace. Whether you have cancer, as Ralph does, whether you've lost all your funds, whether your spouse is divorcing you, whether your kids are on drugs, whatever your problem is in life, and you will have them, and maybe they're little and maybe they're big. The only way you're going to make it through those problems is with the Prince of Peace, the only one who can give you peace, the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. When you look at people that are going through hell and they say, you know, you look at them and they're happy, they're joyful. And you say, how can you be joyful? There's only one way, and that's through Jesus Christ. So you and I can have peace even when there is none. The problem is these people weren't turning to God. These people were doing what they wanted to do. They were having fun. They were, such as the time of Noah, I might say, eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage and not paying attention to what was going to happen. That was the time of Noah. Jesus relates it to the end times. Obviously, it was happening here too. Verse 26. Disaster will come upon disaster, and rumor will be added to rumor. Wow, that kind of sounds like some of the things we're hearing today. Rumor to rumor, disaster upon disaster. I mean, what we're saying here is everything's going to be multiplied. This isn't just a tough day. This is multiplied by multiplied. This is famine and sword and pestilence and all these things multiplied because it's disaster upon disaster. There's no hope. And yet, as he's saying this, they're still 6 years out. They got 6 years to walk through this, folks. What would you do if it was 6 years, if things got this way now and it was 6 years before Jesus came to take the church away? Would you be able to survive? And I'm not just talking about with stocked up, stockpiled food and money and guns and whatever else you think you might need. Are you able to survive 6 years? What would you do? The only one thing, one answer for me, and that's Jesus. You do what you can do, but you're going to eventually run out of food, probably eventually run out of ammunition. You're not going to be able to get to the grocery store. The only way you're going to survive moment by moment, day by day, is through the Prince of Peace. Did these people turn to the Prince of Peace? Did they turn to God? No. They were told by Jeremiah what was going to happen. They were told by Ezekiel what was going to happen. And they still didn't turn to God. So I need to ask you, you've seen it in Ezekiel, and you're going to continue to see it. You've been hearing it, what's going to happen before Jesus returns. Are you doing anything about it? Are you prepared spiritually? Verse 27 says God didn't ignore anyone on this. He says the kings will mourn, the prince will be clothed with horror, the hands of the people of the land will tremble. According to their conduct, I will deal with them, and by their judgments, I will do what? Judge them. Why? That they may know that I am the Lord. That's the reason for all this. They have chosen to turn away from God. Now, let me ask you something. Do you think that they really made a conscious effort to turn away from God?
No, I think Satan got to help them along.
Okay, she said they probably just didn't even care. They got very apathetic and, you know, they just kind of were living life and everything was going along fine. And they just kind of fell down this slippery slope and didn't even realize they were going there. I don't think most people, now I'm very optimistic. I think most people, even though we're sinners, most people in the United States are basically good. Even though we're sinners, understanding that. And probably most people then were basically good. But given to our own devices, we will consistently spiral downward. Because we can never take ourselves to perfection. Only Christ can. If we're left to our own devices, we'll do like we did, like they did in the book of Judges, and that is, everyone will do what is right in his own eyes. Just look at the United States. I agree. When I said most people are good, you know, does that mean 51%? I don't know. But I believe that there's a reasonable percentage, based on what I've seen, I'm guessing maybe 10%, maybe less, of people who are trying to destroy our country, trying to take God out of our country, trying to bring us into a socialistic country, trying to turn us, give up our amendment rights, trying to bring all these changes into schools, trying to take out the Bible and the prayer in the schools, bringing abortion in, getting us to bringing sex in first, because when you have sex, then you have to have abortions, because then you have to take care of your sex. And then you have to have all these other, then you have to have free marriages or no marriage, because you have to, you know, you see, it's a spiraling downward. If somebody had come in 50, 70 years ago and just said, we're going to have same-sex marriages today, the whole country would have been in uproar. So there's this concerted effort by a percentage of people to gradually get into our government, our Hollywood, our media, our schools, and our churches. You know, just a second. I was listening to the book of Mark today. And in chapters 1 and 2, both of them struck me, and I can't take you right there now because I was listening to it. Both of them struck me that there was a demon, a possessed demon in the synagogue, and Jesus healed him. And it dawned on me, there was a demon in the synagogue. That was in chapter 1. And in chapter 2, there was another situation where a demon was in the synagogue. Well, if there's demons in the synagogues at the time of Jesus, you know there's demons in the churches today. That's happening. There's a concerted effort to destroy our churches from within. So, yes, thanks for bringing that up, Chuck, because I do believe there's a concerted effort out there. I believe most people have a good, they don't know we're going down the slippery slope.
They don't want to know it.
They don't want to know it. And I was that way, too. Yeah, I was just living my life comfortably. I'll give you an example. I won't say who it was, but somebody I know, after the last election, was so disappointed in the election. They had put all their time and effort working and thinking and reading and knowing everything about the last election. And when their candidate lost, they were just so disgruntled. That was it. She said, I'm done. It's too much. I can't do anything about it. Nothing changed. And so she just stopped reading the newspaper. She stopped reading the magazine. That was 4 years ago, folks, and she just kind of veggied out. Because we get to a point where we just want to put our heads in the sand because it's too emotional when we don't think we can do something about it. I'm sorry to have made you wait. Oh, yeah, the government through Homeland Security has labeled Christians and terrorists. They did that quite a while ago. And, so things are changing in our country. Well, I don't know how we got off on that rabbit trail, but let's now move into chapter 8. Yeah, I told you there's a lot of good application in these verses, some that I was thinking about and some that just are popping up to me now. As we begin chapter 8, we're coming now to the second vision. When was the first vision? Chapter 1. That was the first vision that we saw when God called him to be his spokesperson. Now we're coming into the second vision. And it says, it came about in the sixth year on the fifth day of the sixth month, as I was sitting in my house with the elders of Judah sitting before me, that the hand of the Lord fell on me there. So based on looking back at chapter 1 to figure out the timing, what year would this be? Okay, 591. I'm going to show you some slides tonight that say 592 on them because I got them off somebody's website. Sometimes we differentiate a year or two, especially when you're dealing with Babylonian and Jewish calendars. So don't worry about the change there. But I believe this is 591 BC. It's 14 months after chapter 1. So chapters 1 through 7 happened about 592 BC. This is happening about 591 BC. He's sitting in his house, and who's with him? Verse 1, the elders of Judah. Okay, so the leaders from Israel who are with him, and remember, he's in Babylon. And it says, the hand of the Lord fell upon me. Have we seen that before? When he had his first vision, it said, the hand of the Lord fell upon him. Verse 2. Then I looked, and behold, a likeness as the appearance of a man from his loins and downward. There was the appearance of fire, and from his loins and upward, the appearance of brightness, like the appearance of glowing metal. He stretched out the form of a hand and caught me by the lock of my head. And the Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven and brought me in the visions of God. So that's why we know this is a vision. Visions of God to Jerusalem, to the entrance of the north gate of the inner court, where the seat of the idol of jealousy, which provokes to jealousy, was located. Now let's go back to verse 2. Who is this describing? Ask me this. Have you seen this before in the book of Ezekiel? Chapter 1. This is exactly how probably the angel of the Lord, which would be Jesus, was described in chapter 1. Probably. In chapter 1, verse 26, it also matches up with how Jesus is described in Revelation, chapter 1, verse 15. So we believe this is probably Jesus. Now, what happened? What did the Spirit do in verse 3? He lifted him up by the back of the neck, grabbed that hair on the back of the neck, and just whisked him away to Jerusalem. Do you think he actually went to Jerusalem? No. Okay, why not? That's right. Yeah. A hologram. A vision. He didn't really go to Jerusalem. He's in Babylon. God didn't rapture him out and take him to Jerusalem and bring him back. This is a vision. But it's a vision of what city? Jerusalem. Okay. Now, let me explain these places to you. Well, first of all, here's just a picture of what that vision may have looked like, what the pre-incarnate Christ may have looked like based on the description that we see here. I just can't even imagine something like this. Wouldn't you just fall down and worship if you saw? Wow, I mean, you'd just never be the same. You wonder how people can do that standing on a street corner with a sign that says the end is near, or how you can go out and preach Jesus all the time. It's because you've had a vision of Jesus somehow, some way. Ezekiel had. Now, let's read verses 3 and 4. I did read verses 3 and 4. Let me read verse 4, and then I'll show you the picture. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, like the appearance which I saw in the plain. If you remember from chapter 1, he saw the glory of God in chapter 1. So that's kind of what we just saw there. Now, let's look at this map, because this gives us an idea of what the temple looked like that Solomon built. When it talks here about, in verse 3, about going to Jerusalem to the entrance of the north gate of the inner court, it's talking about the north gate of the inner court of the temple. It says where the seat of the idol of jealousy is, and we'll discuss that in a minute when we get there. The tabernacle in the wilderness was laid out this way. Solomon's temple was laid out this way. The second temple, Herod's temple, Zerubbabel's temple. That second temple is called three things, any of those. Second temple, Herod's temple, Zerubbabel's temple. They're all laid out the same way. Now, each one was ordained a little differently, depending on how God told them to ordain it, or depending on what Herod decided to do for the second temple. But they're all laid out the same way, in a rectangle. You have the entrance, the east gate, the entrance to the tabernacle area or the temple area, the bronze altar where they conducted the sacrifices, the laver, the bronze basin, also known as the laver where they washed themselves before the ritual things, the portico here of Solomon, there in Herod's temple, Solomon's portico means something different, but here is the portico, and you have two pillars there. One pillar is called Jachin, and the other is Boaz. When you walk into the temple, the first place you see is the what? The holy place. Priests could go into the holy place because in the tabernacle, it was a little different. You had the table of showbread on your right, the candlestick, the menorah on your left, the table of showbread in front of you. Here in Solomon's temple, much more ornate. So they had several tables of showbread and several menorahs right there next to each other on the right and left with the altar of incense. Then you have that dotted line. What does that represent? Okay, that was the veil that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies. Why did it need a veil to separate itself? That's right. Only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies once a year. So nobody else could go in there. You didn't look in there. You didn't peek beyond the curtain. You couldn't do that, or you would be killed. That was where God dwelt with the people. And according to this, it says in verse 4, the glory of God of Israel was there. So was he there when he was snatched out of Babylon in the vision before he went to Jerusalem? Or was he there here in the temple? Well, however you see it, we know later that God was here in the temple. God was dwelling on that Ark of the Covenant, on the mercy seat, on the Ark of the Covenant, at this time in 591 B.C. So you get an idea of this. It's really very simple on the layout. Ezekiel was told to walk in what gate? The north gate. So you see the upper or north gate in there. We're going to read several different things that happen, and then at the end I'm going to show you what it may have looked like. Verses 5 and 6. This is the first abomination. Then he said to me, Son of man, raise your eyes now toward the north. So I raised my eyes toward the north, and behold, the north of the altar gate was this idol of jealousy at the entrance. And he said to me, Son of man, do you see what they are doing? The great abominations which the house of Israel are committing here, so that I would be far from my sanctuary. But yet you will see still greater abominations. We can't see it. We didn't see it on that chart, but we know that this idol of jealousy was right inside that northern gate. The question is, what is the idol of jealousy? Asherah? Okay, it could have been a statue of Ashtaroth or Ashtaroth. Who is Asherah or Ashtaroth? The two different ways to spell it. A Canaanite goddess. One, depending on how you spell it, was the mother of Baal, and the other one was the wife of Baal. Why would one of those be there? I mean, they were worshiping these, the Baal gods and the Asherah, up on the high mountains, but why on the Temple Mount? 2 Kings 21. He said that Solomon married, if you recall, 300 wives and 700 concubines, which God had said don't do, because if you do, they'll bring their gods in. We do know historically and biblically from 1 Kings chapter 11 that he did allow them to bring in foreign gods into Jerusalem. You can, well, you can't really see it today, but you could see it probably 20 years ago, an actual altar to Moloch in the Kidron Valley, which is just right outside the Temple Mount. So he did allow that kind of worship. So it could be from that. Now, let me give you some dates here. You and I are talking here about 591 BC. Solomon was king from 970 to 940 BC. So it was 400 years before this. He built the temple. He completed it in 961 BC. Started it in 966, completed it in 961. So the temple's been built for almost 400 years. All right, just to give you an idea of timing when we go in here. Now, if we look at 2 Kings chapter 21, verse 7, this is a story of Manasseh. He was the most evil king of the southern kingdom. He reigned from 695 to 642 BC. So he's, give or take, 50 years before this. It says in verse 7, 2 Kings 21:7, the Manasseh set the carved image of Asherah that he had made where? In the house of the Lord, in the temple. And it even goes on to say, in the house of the Lord, when the Lord said to David and to his son, in this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen from all the tribes of Israel, I will put my name forever. So in case you miss what that house is, he makes it clear. This is a description of the temple. So Manasseh put an Asherah pole in the temple. Now, fortunately, the next king was a good king, King Josiah. King Josiah, well, he wasn't the exact next king, but the second king over, he reigned from 640 to 609. And Josiah was a good king. And he tore that down, according to chapter 23, verse 6, where it says, 2 Kings, chapter 3, verse 6, and he brought out the Asherah from the house of the Lord. So he tore it down. But once it's built, even if it's torn down, remember, this is like a totem pole. What do you think the people are going to do?
Rebuild.
Yeah, as soon as Josiah is gone, they're going to erect it again because they remember what their families did. Or there is going to be a stump there, and they'll start worshiping the stump. Whatever it is, it's believed that that was the idol of jealousy. It doesn't take much. I mean, quite frankly, if you want to, you could worship a Kleenex right here. You know, just hold it up and put it on an altar, and some people will worship it. So you can worship a stump, too. So that's probably what this idol of jealousy was. It was at the entrance of the north gate, and what did God call it in verse 6? Abomination. And who's committing this abomination? The house of Israel. Everybody. That's important. This first abomination is the idol of jealousy, and everybody's committing an abomination here. And God says, you're going to even see worse things than this. So let's go to the second abomination in verses 7 to 10. Then he brought me to the entrance of the court. This is a little different. And when I looked, behold, there was a hole in the wall. And he said to me, son of man, now dig through the wall. So I dug through the wall, and behold, an entrance. And he said to me, go in and see the wicked abominations that are being committed here. So according to what we saw in verse 6, whatever is going to happen here is going to be worse than this idol of jealousy. Verse 10, so I entered and looked, and behold, every form of creeping thing and beast and detestable things with all the idols of the house of Israel were carved on the wall all around. That's really pretty interesting. What's wrong with carving some things on the walls? They were worshiping animals. Well, what's wrong with worshiping animals? I mean, they kill animals and they sacrifice them, so why can't you worship them? Exodus 20, 1, 2, and 3. I am the Lord your God. You shall have no gods before me. First commandment. Second commandment. You shall have no graven images. These are graven images. Turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 6. Because here God pretty well makes it clear when he's talking about what they can put in the temple. In 1 Kings chapter 6 verse 9. Verse 29. It says, talking about this temple that Solomon's going to build. It says, then he carved all the walls of the house round about with carvings and engravings of cherubim, that's angels, palm trees, open flowers, inner and outer sanctuary. So flowers were okay. Palm trees, you know, those aren't things that they worshipped. They could put those in the temple, but they couldn't put these other things in the temple. This wasn't an abomination. That's why when you go to Israel today and they show you different stones of what was in the synagogues or in the temple, they never have anything but palm trees and flowers and some fruit and things like that in them, because God said not to. Those are graven images. So these people have put graven images on their walls. But where are these walls? They're inside. They're hidden. So these people, let's find out who these people are. Verses 11 and 12 and 13. It says, standing in front of them were 70 elders of the house of Israel, with Jezaniah, the son of Shaphan, standing among them, each man with a censer in his hand, and the fragrance of the cloud of incense rising. So who are these 70 elders? They're the priests, because they have the censers in their hand. They're the only ones. Priests are the only ones that can worship and give service in the temple or the tabernacle. So these are 70 priests. Verse 12. Then he said to me, son of man, do you see what the elders of the house of Israel are committing in the dark, each man in his room of his carved images? For they say, the Lord doesn't see us. The Lord has forsaken the land. And he said to me, yet you will see even greater abominations which they are committing. In the first abomination, you had the idol of jealousy and everybody was publicly worshiping it. Now you have the priests. But they're not worshiping in public. They're doing what? Worshiping in private, because nobody can see them. They're hiding it. Do you know that statistically 34% of pastors consistently look at pornography? 34% of pastors. And you and I are going to say, well, it's not my pastor, but it's got to be somebody's. And if they're looking at pornography, what else are they doing? The number of people that we're seeing fall from the pulpit is staggering in this day and age. Now, granted, there's more temptations, and I believe if we don't pray for our spiritual leaders, our pastors, that even more will fall. But a lot's happening because they're just as susceptible as you and I are. There was a 60-minute expose years ago where they covered the face of these guys, but they got on there as pastors and said, I can't stand what I do. I hate it, but I'm not trained to do anything else, so I just keep on day by day doing what I'm doing, just waiting until I can retire. I mean, there's people out there that are priests and pastors that are doing just what these guys did. Now, it's bad enough that the people are doing it, but why do you think the people are doing it? They have no leadership. Their pastors are doing it. Why do you think what's happening in the country is happening in the country? Because our leaders are doing it, and we're following them. So this is the Levites, the priests, the leaders. By the way, the name, just for those of you who care about this, Jezaniah is mentioned four times in Scripture. We're going to see it in chapter 11, but it's not the same guy. Four times, it's always a different guy. This one happens to be the son of Shaphan. Now, what's fascinating here is he's specifically mentioned here. And yet, it was his father, if you follow that back, his immediate father, who was Shaphan, who found the book, was one of the people who found the book and read the book of the Bible to King Josiah that brought revival to the country. So this guy's father was involved in a huge revival, and now he's worshiping graven images in the inside inner circle of his house. Doesn't take long, does it, folks? Third abomination, verses 14 and 15. Then he brought me to the entrance of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north. And behold, who was sitting there? Women. And what were they weeping for? Tammuz. Tammuz. Now, there's a particular month in the Jewish calendar called Tammuz, but it's not named after this particular person. And he said to me, verse 15, do you see this, son of man? Yet you will still see greater abominations. Are you catching that phrase each time? You're going to see worse abominations every time we think it can't get any worse. So now you have the women. First you had all the people, then you had the priests and the elders. Now you have the women, and they're weeping over Tammuz. So who is Tammuz? Okay, a Sumerian god of vegetation, or a Phoenician god of vegetation. Anyway, it was a false god of vegetation. And because it's vegetation, we can see it now with spring here, you have a period of time in the fall when things start to die away. And in the winter, everything's dead. In the spring, it comes back and it's nice and green again. So if this is the god of vegetation, would there be a time of mourning for the god of vegetation? Yeah, when everything's dead. When they have no food to eat because it's dead, it's dormant at that time of the year. So they're weeping for this god of vegetation because they have no food being produced. They're hungry. They're starving. Remember, there's a famine. And they're weeping to this god, which means they've been worshiping this god. Instead of the god who created the heavens and the earth and all the land and all the vegetation, they're worshiping another god. Why do we do that? Just think about it. Why do we worship angels? Why do we worship or pray to saints? Why do women weep for Tammuz? We were made to worship. There's a spirit inside of each one of us. That's what lives forever. We have a desire to worship. And if we're not going to worship God, we're going to worship something else. Any other thoughts? I think that's the number one answer. He says, speaking as a former Catholic, but I think any of us could say this. We don't feel we're worthy enough to go directly to God, because God's God. Nobody can see God and live. The Bible says we will in eternity, but here we can't. So, and we don't feel worthy to go directly to God. So it's much easier to go through our dead parents or the saints or somebody else or angels who stand before the throne of grace. Much easier to go to them and say, okay, would you go to God for me? Or as the Catholic Church has taken it, to Mary, in making Mary the co-redemptress. You know, she's a saint and they've done that with her and elevated her to a different position. It's much easier to go to somebody else. I mean, if you've done something, if you were a kid, if you ever did this, and I'm sure none of you did, but I did, and you did something wrong, I'd go tell my mom first. Because my father was the authoritarian in the house. He was German, you know, and I knew I was going to get it from him. Mom wasn't as likely to do that. So we ease it through mom to get it to dad, so I don't have to go directly to dad. Well, that's what happens here. We either we're not worthy, or we're afraid, or we think, if I'm going to pray to the only God in the universe, I better make sure I'm worthy of praying. Therefore, I have to make sure I'm cleansed, you know, spiritually and stuff. And, I don't want that. I want what I want, but I don't want to have to do this to get there. I don't have to be spiritual to get there. Yeah. He mentioned Semiramis, whatever the name is. If you can go look it up and you can find out a whole bunch of history of Tammuz and some of the other things and the idea of of this goddess holding a three-year-old child and some other things that become idol worship. But I think you've got the idea here. Women are worshiping something that isn't God for fertility. And God says it's just going to keep getting worse, so he gives us the fourth abomination, verses 16 and 17. He brought me into the inner court of the house of the Lord's house. Excuse me, the inner court of the Lord's house. So he's in the temple right now. It says, and behold, at the entrance to the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs to the temple of the Lord and their faces towards the east. And what were they doing? Worshiping the sun. Now, I know people now that pray to Jerusalem because that's where God's holy city is. I mean, not Christians as well as Jews will pray to Jerusalem. These people are turning their backs on God and praying to the sun. When you go to the temple, to the Wailing Wall today, most of the Jews, if the Wailing Wall is right here, they will back away from the Wailing Wall like this so that they don't turn their backs on God. And yet these people are turning their backs on God. That's right. It's honor. It's a sign of honor not to turn your back on it. You can look it up on your own, but 2 Kings 23:5, at the end of the verse, it talks about how Josiah was tearing down the high places, but also those who burn incense to Baal, to the sun, to the moon, to the constellations. So they were used to worshiping the sun. It's one thing to worship the sun. That's horrible. But they're doing it in the Holy of Holies. In the holy place with their backs to God. Does it get any worse? Each time these abominations get worse. And it says, they have committed. Then verse, so this is the fourth abomination. When I look at our country, I think as I see us going, well, I see us take, I didn't see it, but I look back. And I see that we took the Bible out of schools. The Bible was the primary textbook for all schools until the late 1800s. That's what they used for textbooks. Then they took the Bible out. Supreme Court took the Bible out of school. Then in the early 60s, they took prayer out of the schools. And so do you see each abomination? Then, after the sexual revolution, they allowed the killing of our offspring. Children are a blessing to the Lord, and we allowed the killing of our offspring. Do you see abomination after abomination after abomination? And now the sanctity of marriage, which according to Ephesians 5 is an example of Christ in the church, has been defiled by the Supreme Court. All these decisions, by the way, are Supreme Court decisions. Shows you how important this next Supreme Court justice is. But do you see abomination after abomination after abomination? And God keeps saying, he says it all the way down, yet you will still see even greater abominations than this. So what's the consequence? Oh, let me give you the consequence first. In Ezekiel 8:18, therefore, I indeed will deal in wrath. My eye will have no pity, nor will I spare. And though that you cry, they cry in my ears with a loud voice, I won't listen to them. Why do we think God should listen to us when we commit abomination after abomination after abomination, just like is happening here? He shouldn't. He has no reason to listen to us. Sure, he'll listen to you and I. He listens to believers. He loves the prayers of his saints. They're incense before the throne of grace. But unless we get on our knees as believers and we petition the throne of mercy and grace to change our country, we are fallen. Just look at what we've seen here in Ezekiel. We're the same way. Going back here now, you've got a chart. This chart comes from a website I got, Generation Word. By the way, almost all, unless I say they're mine, everything I put up here, I'm getting off the internet. It's not mine. I don't claim it. But this I thought was really good because it gives you a good picture. He comes in the north gate. There you have it. That circle is the idol of jealousy. He breaks through the wall over there where the elders live. That's where we saw all the graven images carved. He comes over here to the women up here who are crying for Tammuz. Here again, all in the court of the temple. And then he comes to the portico right in front of the temple. And that's where he sees the men turning their backs towards God. They have completely desecrated the temple. So you know what God's going to do? He's not only going to destroy them, but in chapter 9, he's going to leave we begin to see in chapter 9 and chapter 10 and chapter 11 that God and the glory of God leaves, because the glory of God will not be there when he brings his wrath on this people. Do you think the glory of God has left our country? Do you think he's left our world right now? Well, God is everywhere. But when God takes his glory out, that means his wrath is coming. That's another reason I believe in the pre-tribulation rapture, because we are God's glory here on earth. We're his representative. And he will take us out before his wrath comes. But folks, it's coming. We cannot turn our back on God. Maybe we're not worshiping the sun, but we're worshiping everything else that isn't God. We can't turn our backs on God without there being a consequence. What are you going to do for yourself, for your circle of influence, what God has called you to do, to try and be a voice for God, to turn our country back to the one true God? That's really what it boils down to. Because if my people, by the way, do you know that 2 Chronicles 7:14 that I'm going to quote here was given by God to Solomon right after he finished building the temple? He says, if my people, that's you, who are called by my name, that's those of you who are born again believers, will humble yourselves and pray. Got to humble first, then pray, then seek my face, then repent, turn from your wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven, promise, I will forgive your sins, and I will heal your land. That's the only way this land is going to be healed, folks. And it starts with you, and you, and you, and me, anyone who calls themselves a believer in Jesus Christ. Are you going to take God's calling on your life and take action with it? Let's pray. Father, you have called each one of us to repent, to humble ourselves, to pray, to seek your face, and to repent. We must do that. That's the only way this land is going to be healed. The people in Ezekiel's time didn't do it. You warned them, and you warned them, and you tell us the abominations that they did that are no different than the abominations we're doing. They just have different names to them. But the heart attitude's the same. Even some of the actions are the same. It's all about ourselves. It's not about you. God, there's no difference from Ezekiel's time to our time. We need you in this country. Most importantly, we need you in ourselves. Well, your Holy Spirit indwells us. But Father, we need you to fill us mightily so we're empowered to go stand on a street corner with a sign if you call us to, or to go speak the truth to whomever you call us to do. We need to be your voices in a world that doesn't want to hear, because you call us to do that. So Father, I pray that you will go before us, give us wisdom and strength, give us peace and power to speak the truth of God wherever you lead us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today on Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank. Living Word Ministries is a listener-supported program. To contact Debbie Blank, you may do so at livingwordministry.org. That's www.livingwordministry.org. Please tune in each week at the same time for Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank.